Hi everybody, and welcome to another round of One Voice Christian Church YouTube channel online services. My name is Emma, and we're going to get straight into today's service. So, if you're new here, you're going to find that we have a pretty simple system that we always follow. If you've been around for a while, you know what's coming now. That's right, we're about to kick off our service with some worship music, so please make sure that you've turned your volume right up. Doesn't matter how you sound, I promise you that. Just set your heart to worship the Lord, and that's all that you need to worry about. Have a great listen, have a great watch of the lyrics in the songs that we've chosen for you today, and feel God pouring His love into you so that you can worship Him more. I will see you right back here after worship.
God so loved the world that He gave us His one and God so loved the world.
darkness, my God, that is who you are. In the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here and you're healing every heart. I worship you.
Thank you. what Calvary has bought for me, both now and forever.
Savior ever true, oh Jesus, Jesus, we turn our eyes to you.
Weren't those songs amazing? Such a great way to kick off our morning service. And the lyrics always speak to my heart. As we move right along in our service, we're now coming up to communion. And today we've got Tony Swanbury bringing you the communion message. So please make sure that you've got your elements, whatever it is that you use to represent the body and the blood of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ. And maybe have a pen and paper. I have a feeling that Tony's going to have some beautiful nuggets for you that speak straight to your heart from the Lord. I'll see you at the table very, very shortly.
As I was singing, there's just a few of us here today. I believe the Holy Spirit said to me, I'm here. God is here. He's surrounding us, and even the hosts of heaven even looking down on us. It's an awesome thing that God is omnipresent. In other words, He's everywhere. We cannot. And so He's watching today. Earlier in the week, I thought, Lord, what do I talk about today? I was a bit dry, I think. And He said, what are you celebrating? And it was Anzac Day. And people all over Australia were remembering the men and the women who laid down their lives, gave up their lives, that we might be free, free from being run by another country and controlled. Lest we forget is the, and the beautiful sounds, and Jesus said, for we are to remember as well. And as I began to think about this, the comparing Anzac Day and then comparing that with what God has done, when we see God in heaven takes on the devil. He takes on the devil because he has power of sin and death that he can hold over mankind and blocking the way and access to him. So God sends his son to lay down his life for you and I, to make a way, to rip up the veil that prevented man from being able to have access to God. So today we come and celebrate the victory that Jesus won for us over sin and death. We come to declare our love and faith in Him. We can today, if you like, lay a wreath of worship and thanksgiving and raise our voice as we have done in praise. Can we put up Revelation, please, chapter 1, verses 4 to 6. I found this interesting. Why God took me there, I don't know, but the Holy Spirit led me to these scriptures. John says to the seven churches which are in Asia, and I think speaks to us today as well in this world, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, from the seven spirits are before his throne. That's the first part of it. Grace to you, to me. Isn't that beautiful? Grace to you and me. And peace. All from God. So this morning, let His grace and His peace flow over you as you come before His throne, before you come communion. Then it goes on to speak about Now, if you go back, please. And from the seven spirits are, who are before his throne. The seven spirits are the wholeness of the Holy Spirit. I guess you could call the manifold presence that the Holy Spirit is. Perfect dynamic activity. That's what it's written, I read, but anyway. Can we go to the next verse, please? And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins with his own blood. It's pretty powerful scriptures, these are. So let the grace and the peace of Jesus Christ flow in your hearts right now. Let it flow. Receive it. God is loving, kind, good. He's the ruler, and he's now triumphant over the kings of the world. All the presidents of the world, all those around the world in the past and forever, he is the king over them. I don't think they'd like to know that. And then to him, he loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Hallelujah. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. You know, we are now Christ redeemed. Through Jesus we have dominion and victory. Sometimes it doesn't feel like that, does it? It doesn't feel like we have dominion and victory, but in Christ we do. Because of him. We've been given privileges, haven't we? As children of God. Amazing privileges. God has called us out to share his love, advance the kingdom of God, and to warfare. Go to warfare against the powers of darkness that come against us. Do you agree with that? God's called us. We are Christ to be washed from our sins. Hallelujah. Can we hand out communion, please? Can we put up Revelation chapter 1, verses 7 and 8 as well? We'll go to that in a moment. This morning I felt to, when we take communion, to do something a little bit different when we have our communion. On Anzac Day, don't worry about a bit of noise, that's not a problem, is it? On Anzac Day, people gather early in the morning and they stand and they remember. So this morning I felt the Holy Spirit say, when you take communion, feel free to kneel, to stand or to sit and honour him who died for us. Amen? After all, when you read the scriptures, he's the Lamb of God. That's who he is for us, the sacrificial Lamb of God, as well as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's also the Lion of the tribe of Judah, so many more things. Amen? You know, as Christ redeemed, we have been given dominion and victory. Designated kings and priests, as it says up here, or we read before. I put this verse up here because it pronounces in many ways our future. We can glorify him in that. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him. And all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. Next verse. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is, who was, and is to come, the Almighty. Amen. Hallelujah. So this morning, right now, feel free to kneel, stand, or we'll just bow our heads for a moment as we remember Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Redeemer, who died for us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus broke bread, gave his Heavenly Father thanks. This partake of him, of his body, broken, given for us in Jesus' name. Reading, please. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them heard I say, blessing and honour and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb for ever and ever. Can we just stand and repeat the last part of that? Just from blessing. And before we take the cup. Blessing and honour and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb for ever and ever. Amen. Let's drink together. Oh, Father, thank you for your Son, that you sent the Son of your love. He gave his life to redeem us and restore us to yourself. Lord, we remember and we give thanks and declare glory and blessing and honour to the Lamb forever and ever. Amen. Thank you.
Did you get some good nuggets out of that one? Thought you might. Now as we move along from communion into our sermon, you are going to be blown away, and make sure you've got more than one piece of paper. Today we've got our beautiful Pastor Cheryl Giles bringing you the sermon for today. And I know that you are going to see this in just such a way that makes you go, wow. And it also gives another definition to the living word that is our Bible. Grab your pen and paper, make sure you've got a drink on hand, and just enjoy and absorb what the Lord is saying through Pastor Cheryl, just for you. We here at One Voice Christian Church really look forward to bringing you these services, so I hope that you find them a blessing. If you think that you know somebody who may wish to, who may benefit from these videos, please feel free to share it. Or do what some people that we know do. Get a room full of people and sit down and watch them on the big screen together. No better way to feast and feed on the Lord than to do it together. Don't neglect the gathering of the brethren. On that note, enjoy Pastor Cheryl's message, stay safe, be blessed, and we will see you right here on another round of One Voice Christian Church YouTube channel's online services.
Morning and welcome. So I've never had a message for today. I'm was too busy being sick. I figure that sickness actually rocked me. I've never felt that sick in my life. I've never felt nothing like it. So I had the two sicknesses at once, and I was actually bedridden. I knew I was supposed to do Wednesday night, so thanks Emma, couldn't even do that. I was supposed to do Monday night, couldn't, so that got cancelled. Emma took my Wednesday. I'm just praying and praying flat out for the Sunday, and amen, I made it.
Praise Jesus.
Yeah, praise Jesus. Never ever felt anything like it. Okay. So this message come Saturday morning, I think I got it. No, Friday night, sorry. I was thinking, okay, I got it Friday night. That don't mean it's going to be the same message Sunday. But amen it is. He never changed it. Can we have the scripture up, please? So in the NIV, Mark 3, 20 to 28. In the NIV, this one's titled, Jesus Accused by His Family and by the Teachers of the Law. This is the title in the NIV. This title alone showed me to think about my family. But we think physical family. But what about my family, me? Everything I carry, my beliefs, my value, my doubt was a part of my family. Shame was a part of my family. It was who I was, not no more. But I want you thinking along that side, along the lines, family. And also about the law, what laws I was putting on myself, what laws I was placing on others. What was I feeding myself? Because what I was feeding myself, I was feeding them. So the title for today is Feed Them Faith. Verse 20. Then Jesus entered a house, and again a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When Jesus came into my life, into my heart, which is my house, a crowd gathered. That was all the old stuff in my life that crowded me. All the old stuff like the unforgiveness, the judgments, the bitterness, the shame, the anger. Everything that crowded my life. Jesus, when he came, everything that he brings weren't even able to come and sit around my table. All these blessings he had for me. That shame was a big one for me. All that stuff I carried. And it was because of this stuff. It says, him and his disciples were not even able to eat. So when I accepted Jesus in my life, I accepted the name, yeah. But what about everything that comes with him? All the blessings that come with him. Everything that makes God, God. Not just the name, not just the concept, but everything he brings. So when I invited my Lord and Savior into my life, into my heart, all of his goodness, all of his love, all of his glory, the fruits of his spirit, they had no room to shine because of the other stuff that was in my life blocking it. Sometimes we hold on tight to stuff we shouldn't, and this actually blocks God's blessing for us. He doesn't stop blessing us. We just deflect it off with what we're carrying. Sorry, go away. Break your equipment. So if I take notice, if you take notice and look back at everything, every struggle you ever went through, if you was to look, God was there. But we're too busy in it to actually see. I was too busy holding to actually receive. Yes. I had to let go to receive the blessing. I'm yarning with a lady now, an Aboriginal lady in the Royal Adelaide, who's been told, you know, severe health issue. She's been told, you might as well, we'll treat you for the week, keep you for the week, and then we're sending you home to Port Augusta. There's nothing we can do for you, no more. I come to know this lady through her son, who actually is a prisoner. This lady's sister rang me, and she recognised my voice. She thought I was Natalie, a twin. I lived in Port Augusta. She said, I know you. I said, no, you know my sister, actually. So I got in through the son and the sister to this lady. I went to, on an escort with the prisoner to visit her. Yes, she has a faith. But she had the concept of Jesus. She didn't have the relationship. She didn't have the experience, the realness. She had a concept of like holding a physical Bible. That was it. Nothing real about it. To go in there and pray for her, and actually, you know, God showed me unforgiveness. I spoke to her about her unforgiveness. And it was through my faith I was able to feed her faith. By feeding her faith, she learned to fight well. She learned to fight well in her faith through prayer, through the truth. You know, I'd like to thank Emma for sharing her journey, to go on that journey and to see Emma feed her faith through that struggle. What have been one of the biggest struggles of her life. But to see her feed her faith. And through her feeding her own faith, she got to feed nurses, other patients, doctors, people in servos along the way. But it also fed my faith. So thank you, Emma, for that. Her faith fed my faith. And in turn, my faith is feeding this lady's faith. So every bit of faith we have, let's use it to feed others. This is to see Emma, you know, live the faith during that. To see the relationship bloom through that. To see her rename the disease. She didn't claim it, she renamed it. She renamed the medication. I was speaking to a guy who delivers rehabilitation to prisoners. I was speaking to him and that lady in the Royal Adelaide. I spoke about renaming. Don't accept what they're putting on you. Rename it, reclaim it for what he's given you. This guy doesn't have faith, but to actually explain that, he was sitting there in awe of that experience, you know, that I was sharing with him. What he said next, you know, actually cemented we're not feeding faith enough. This is a guy with no faith. And so, well, actually, I went through that journey. I wish someone would have told me that when I was going through it. No one told me that. No one showed me how. If we're not showing them, who is? He's constantly finding reasons coming around during breaks. And no, it's not because of me. He said, man, you've got so much wisdom. Well, actually, man, I don't. It's him that does.
Yeah.
You know? But now he knows. You know, no, he ain't saved yet. But that don't stop God moving. That crushed me. I'm the one I need to plant the seed. Someone else to water it. You know, that's not going to hurt me knowing that he's not saved yet. I can't save him, he can. He will send who he wants. Remember, let's feed them faith so they have room at God's table to eat as well. God's got this table of goodness for us, of love, joy, peace, rest, you know, healing. He's got all this good stuff. And we know only the good comes from above. Verse 21, please. When his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, he is out of his mind. Yeah, when people first hear, they think we're out of our mind. They think we're bunta. First few times I shared faith in jail. Can you imagine how they looked at me? But they didn't stop me sharing. Just kept praying opportunities in the community. Give me an opportunity. It took me to stand on what I believe, not to fall for what they were believing, but for me to stand. But by being consistent in your stand, being consistent in your faith, consistent in the words you use, consistent in the prayers, just being consistent, they will end up coming and following for what you have to offer because of him. So when his family heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said he is out of his mind. This is what myself and my thoughts done before I knew Christ. They took charge of me. They told me what to think. They told me how to feel, how to act. Now I have Christ telling me how to think, how to feel, how to act. He takes over my thoughts. Yeah, the enemy still gets in there, but don't give him room to move. Sometimes we have a little door that opens, but don't give it time to go. Don't give it time to kick it wide open. Shut it before he gets it wide open. When I'm talking faith, I have that doubt creep in. That used to be my constant. That was my constant family, was doubt. Now I have a family of truth living with me, surrounded and grounded in the Word. I have peace, authority, joy, love. I won't say patience yet. Working on that. But it's available for me when I need it.
That's right.
It is, see? Andrea agrees. The family I feed is the family that will shine when I speak, how I act. It will be the family. It will be the family of others that listen, what idea of family am I giving them when they hear me speak. Others can hear us all, that they're constantly listening. They might not show it, they might not act it, but they are. You're constantly speaking faith, feed them faith, faith will settle. Verse 22, please. And the teachers of the law who came down from Jerusalem said, he is possessed by Beelzebul, whatever, by the prince of demons. He is driving out demons. If we're speaking faith, we can't be possessed by whoever, speaking demons. These people were listening to the unknown. That's why they assumed this. is the unknown. The lost out there, we're still speaking unknown. But that don't mean stop speaking. You may be the one that plants a seed that someone else comes to water. I remember when, you know, when Luke first spoke to me, at Barmer, I think, play space, we actually got together to organise a family meeting, family barbecue. And God had other ideas, didn't he? No one turned up. But out of that one meeting, God still moved, didn't he? Because look, I'm here. If it wasn't for that meeting, I don't think, I wouldn't be here. It was Luke that took Luke to speak. His faith on me. He fed me faith. And from that feeding, now I can feed. So thanks, Luke, for being obedient. I'm feeding my friend. You know, I used to think God can't use me. People won't listen. That was that shame and that doubt and that all that other stuff that the non-faith used. The fear, the doubt, all that kept me bound. Kept me trapped. But God didn't stop. He used Luke to feed faith. Let's feed them faith out there. You know, to see that bloke say, I wish someone would have told me that. That speaks volumes. They don't know what they don't know unless we teach them. Who else out there is feeding faith? The media ain't. Schools ain't. You know? Who's feeding faith if not us? You know that woman lying in the Royal Adelaide now, just feeding her faith and speaking on that unforgiveness. She didn't want it. And I said, yeah, that's your call. But I'm here if you need. I'm here for prayer if you want. You know my phone number. So I left it with her. She rang me one night. She said, guess what? Real excited and happy. I was able to speak to my so-and-so that I haven't spoken to for so long. There's that unforgiveness. Just by bringing to light that there was an unforgiveness, she didn't even know she had it until someone told her. Sometimes we need to tell them. There's people out there that are that lost and hurting, they don't even know they're lost and hurting. I never knew until I was fed faith. I never knew I was lost. I thought I was going along deadly, could be. Drinking every weekend, it was deadly. I thought, how wrong was I? You know, all them drugs and them sniffing. How wrong was that? But I didn't know any better. No one fed me faith. They fed me a concept. I knew of Jesus. I knew God. I knew he had a son. That was it. I knew Father Abraham had many sons. And that's probably the extent of what I learned growing up. Just by feeding this lady that's laying in the Royal Adelaide faith, her faith led to her forgiving. Her forgiveness led to her results. These tubes, she said, the tubes are running clear. You know, real excited. You're getting the poison out. Yeah, And the doctors reassessed. Now they're treating her. Now she's getting treatment. Just by feeding faith. But feed faith 24/7. Not just on a Sunday. Not just from 9 to 5. The enemy will attack in the dark at night, and when people are lonely, people are home, that's when the enemy will attack. Be available for the phone call or the text message. Even sending someone a scripture is feeding faith. Feed a scripture to them. That language I was using to that lady in the hospital was foreign to her when I first started. Like I was talking of, I don't know, that, you know, for her that was someone that was out of reach. Had to go through someone else to get to him. That was unheard of, the way I was speaking. But because I've seen it in action, I've lived it, you know. We've prayed it. We see it every Sunday, the faith in here. Because of experience that I was able to share it, from there her treatment has started. That's one person. You know, the little fellas in the jail too, feeding them faith. This one that was in Glenside years, you're talking, I don't know, about 4 years ago it could be. He still rings, he rang the other day. Prayer, because he's in language. I don't even know his last name, poor fellow, I can't pronounce it. But that don't stop him wanting his faith fed. You know, he'll still ring me saying, he'll say his name, and then he'll say my brother's name, so I can click a memory of who he is. I said, oh yeah, okay. And I said, pray, me, Nana. And that's it, because he can't speak English. Yet, God gets me to pray in English for him. God still moves. He doesn't need me speaking language. He still moves. Just feeding him a bit of faith. Okay. Be on 22. I'll just read, one voice is unique in the way we care for each other. Not many people have a church like this. Not many people care like we care for each other. We feed each other's faith. I don't know if we realize we're doing it, but we do it, and we do it well here. So what we get here, let's feed out there. We've met our Lord and Saviour. They've still got to meet their Lord and Saviour. Remember to feed their faith. I'm 22:3, please. So Jesus called them over to him and began to speak to them in parables. How can Satan drive out Satan? When Jesus spoke in parables, he spoke a language they knew. Me to be able to pray for that fellow in the lambs, Jesus is speaking a language he knows. I'm praying in English. He knows language, but he's still hearing it. Jesus is still moving. But we also need to be speaking a language they know as well. Feed them faith for where they are at. It says we are what we eat. Let's eat faith so we can share it out there. Teach them according to where they are at. In their sickness, talk faith. Talk hope. That woman, when she's ringing me, she's ringing because I offer hope. And that's it. the hope of him, not me. That hope comes from Jesus. The doctors are speaking facts, and doctors know, maybe I won't say anything. Thank you, Lord, for doctors. I'll say that. Doctors speak facts. The family, when they get the news of their loved one sick, they can't speak at all. They can't think, can't speak, don't know how to feel. So how can they feed faith? They can't usually. It usually takes someone else to come in to feed the faith. So being there for that lady, I was able to feed faith, not only to her, but to the family that was sitting there, to the prisoner that was sitting there. The guards were in the room. They would have heard it. But just giving her hope, that hope she can hold on to. Like that woman with the issue, who held out, reached out for his robe, reached out for that hope. She grabbed it with every inch of her being and healed. When she's feeling like flat and down, and it's usually not a convenient time, it's not during daylight, it's usually late at night, but just that word of encouragement is enough to feed her faith again. That little fellow on the lanes, you know, he's ringing late at night usually. But he rings, he needs to be fed faith, fed hope. So how can Satan drive out Satan? That's what the lost and hurting think. We're doing something not normal for them, so it must be evil. Before I come here and I heard, you know, I've heard of the healings and, well, that's not normal, that's not what I grew up with. Listen, indeed, there must be something other than. But to actually keep being fed the faith, now this is the normal. That wasn't the normal. I thought I was living the normal. To know now this is the normal. It says in the end, things that are good will become evil, and evil will become good. People are seeing that now. Don't be discouraged if they mocked you at first. They mocked Jesus. You know, stand your faith. By you standing your faith, it will feed their faith. Oh, these fellows are standing for something. Keep standing. It says in the Bible to stand and stand and stand again. He spoke about standing on what you believe. Standing on what you know. I stand on what I've experienced, what I know for myself. I stand on my testimony. No one can take that from me, not even the enemy, because it's mine, straight from him to me. So that's what I stand on. Could I get verse 24? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. Next one. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand. And if Satan opposes himself and is divided, he cannot stand. His end has come. If we're not feeding our faith, what are we feeding? You know, when you walk in a hospital room with family that don't have faith, there's guards there that don't have faith. There's nurses that come in and out that don't have faith. The patient has a concept of faith, but not a living, lived, real experience of faith. You see the fear just rise, like you see it just move. Fear just takes over. And along comes fear, comes death and all that. You feel it. But if you walk in your faith, feeding faith, you know, what can come near? What can stand? Nothing. Nothing can stand in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let's walk in feeding faith. Walk in shops feeding faith. Walk in Woolies feeding faith. Feed it wherever you go. Feed people faith. That moment when, before you walk in, pray before, pray during, and pray after. Thank Him for after for moving. You know, always thank Him for moving. It's Him that moves. It's easy to fit in, walk in a hospital room full of fear, and it's easy to walk in fear in there. If you're not praying beforehand, you're going to walk in and fall. In that fear. It's gonna grip. It's gonna get a hold. Don't give the enemy room to move. Faith comes from hearing, not seeing. As soon as people hear faith, they hear your stand. They hear about the goodness, about the power, authority, the healing, the peace, the joy, the love. Let them hear it. When they hear it, their faith will be fed. It says, a kingdom divided will not stand. A faith divided will not stand either. Keep your faith on one track, just to Him. Let go and let God move. He's the one, after all, that does the saving, does the healing, does the deliverance. Well, I was talking to a young fellow in the community recently. You know, God's been placing this young fellow on my heart for a few days. Every day when I had to work, okay, Lord, if this is the day you want me to see him and tell him, bring him across my path. Because I've got to go to work, I can't go out of my way searching for him because I've got to work. So I said, okay, Lord, you bring him across my path. First week, nothing. During the second week, right near the end of the week, just praying that prayer, bring him across my path. Sure enough, here he comes. That's the right time I had to share. I said, okay, Lord, he's ready to receive, must be. He mustn't have been ready before, unless God would have put him across my path. And to let him know about his guilt, you know, feeling that guilt, let him to ice, and that addiction. Talking about, you know, God is not to blame. If you're looking at God as your problem, you won't see Him as a solution. You know, it's good to see that young fellow now smiling, happy. But given to feeding them when they're ready. Don't try and feed them when they're not. Feed them when they're ready. And God knows when they're ready. You know, just feeding Him now, He will be feeding others. Verse 27, last one.
One more.
In fact, no one can enter a strong man's house without first tying him up, then he can plunder the strong man's house. The enemy can't rob, steal, kill, destroy our faith unless we let him. If your faith is strong and grounded in the truth, the enemy can't touch it. He wants to take what God's given you, that faith, and destroy it. Why would the enemy want you sharing your faith? He doesn't want them unbound. He doesn't want them walking in freedom. He doesn't want them saved. Keep your faith. Keep feeding your faith. The more you feed your faith, the more faith you got to give. We can only give out what we got. Let's use what God has given us from the day of our salvation. And that is power, love, and a sound mind. You know, too many people out there got no power. That was a word I used to use as well. I was weak. You know, I can't deny I'm too weak to do that. Cheryl, you can't talk to them. Nah, I can't do that, too weak. God come to give us power, love and a sound mind. Let's use it for the world out there. Let's feed them power, love and a sound mind by feeding their faith. I didn't know I was blind and deaf. They don't know they're blind and deaf. I wasn't fed faith, I was fed lies. But that was my faith in lies. I didn't know any better. They don't know any better either. They don't know what they need saving from. Let's today use our faith to feed their faith. Before I finish, I'd like to just do a prayer for all of us around our faith. So if we could just bow our heads. Lord, we just thank you and praise you, Father, because of your faith, Lord, that we have faith, Lord. We thank you that we have that faith, Lord. Each and every person in this church today is here because of their faith, Lord. Lord, take their faith. Use their faith. Multiply their faith, Lord. Use it out there in a community, Lord, that is lost, hurting, Lord. Use our faith in our workplaces, Lord, to lift and raise salvation in the community, Lord. Let's multiply the kingdom, Lord, by the faith that we carry. The faith in you, Jesus, and the faith in the one and only King of Kings. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for the faith given. We thank you for the power, the love, and the sound mind we each have been given. Lord, we just thank you and praise you, the Lord, that every scripture is purposed, appointed, and anointed to feed our faith. Lord, we just bind them scriptures to our heart and our mind. In Jesus' name. Amen. That's my message for the day. I'm praying it blessed someone. I'm here to pray if anyone wants to pray. But you know the takeaway, feed your faith too. Start by praying for each other. Let's pray for each other as well. That way we're feeding our faith.